Martinson Talks Books. My guest today, Margaret Wertheim, who is a science writer, has written an interesting book called Physics on the Fringe. It is subtitled Smoke Rings, Circulons, and Alternative Theories of Everything, published by Walker. Welcome, Margaret.
Lovely to be here, Connie.
And what were you, you were trained, what, as a scientist before you became a science writer?
Yes, I went to university and studied physics and mathematics and thought I would be a professional physicist, but ultimately decided to become a science writer and communicator instead.
Why? What was the difference?
I think one of two things. One is I realized at university that although I loved the science, I didn't want to remain in a completely sheltered environment as physics was back then. And I also just realized I very much wanted to share my love of this subject with my friends. Many of my friends were artists and filmmakers, and they loved science but felt they couldn't understand the books that the physicists wrote. And so I wanted to write books and engage my friends with physics in ways that were really creative and innovative.
Well, Physics on the Fringe is based partly on a man named Jim Carter. Mm-hmm. Who is a man who is, well, he's unique, as you portray him in this book, living on a trailer park that he owns. We're in a place that the name I find trouble like pronouncing, M-U...
Enumclaw.
E-M-U-Claw.
Enumclaw.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And that's a community about an hour south of Seattle.
And also, he had lived, which I thought was marvelous, on Catalina as an abalone fisher.
Yes, yes. In the 1970s, Jim was part of the abalone diving fleet, and which sold abalone from Catalina all over the world to restaurants in New York and Tokyo, London, etc.
But it allowed him a week to work, but then a couple of months to do what he loved to do, which was invent.
Yes, Jim, and particularly what Jim loved to invent, more than anything, is theories of the universe, or a theory of the universe. He believes that he has found the true and final theory of the universe, which will basically mean that he's not only the next Einstein, but actually the next Newton. So people have been searching for the final theory of physics for a long time, and Jim believes he's found it.
Has he?
Has he? Well, that depends what you mean by the word final, Connie.
Yeah.
I believe that none of the people I chronicle in my book are going to win the Nobel Prize for physics or ever be taught in physics departments at Stanford and Princeton and MIT. That said, I think they've done something extraordinary. I think Jim has given us a completely brilliant imaginative conception of what the world might be.
Uh-huh.
But I don't think he's ever going to be taught to physics students.
You said that you, as a science writer, that almost anybody who writes a thing on science sends it to you.
I get a lot of these in the mail.
Yes.
Particularly since the book's come out, I've got a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I have a whole library of them, hundreds of them. And that's what ultimately prompted me to write this book, is why there's so many people doing it. If it was just Jim Carter, mm-hmm. one man alone coming up with an alternative theory of the universe, it'd just be a quirky anomaly. But there are thousands of these people out there, and I wanted to try to understand why they're doing it.
Yeah, why?
Well, that's the question my book set out to try to answer.
Mm-hmm.
What does it mean that a man in a trailer park is trying to find his own theory of physics? And the conclusion I came to is basically that what's going on here is that people like Jim, they love science.
Have they been trained at all?
Mostly not. Some of them have, but mostly, like Jim has no training in science. He has no education after high school. But he loves science, and he feels that science is the right way to understand the world. But when he reads something like Stephen Hawking's book, A Brief History of Time, or Brian Greene's book about string theory, he can't understand it.
I have to tell you, I did a show with Brian Greene on string theory, and I really don't understand it, even having had it explained.
Well, I think this is a fundamental problem now, is that these theories of physics are inaccessible to 99.99% of people, but yet we're told this is our theory of reality. And a lot of people just accept that and say, well, I'll never understand it. But people like Jim, say, no, I don't believe that nature speaks a language that the ordinary person can't understand. I believe that nature is accessible to me. Mm-hmm. And these physicists, they've gone off on this wrong track. And yeah. I'm going to work it out for myself.
Yeah. How did you, you said you were at a bookstore and a friend of yours said, this just came in, I was going to dump it, but maybe you'll be interested?
Yes. I came across Jim because in 1993 he sent an announcement out about the imminent publication of his own book to a bunch of scientific booksellers.
Yeah.
And one of them happened to give a copy of this to me.
Yeah.
And I thought it was very audacious that, you know, he was this man who had claimed that he'd reinvented physics from the ground up. He had a whole theory of subatomic physics. He had a whole theory of gravity. Mm-hmm. He had a whole theory of the creation of the universe. And he'd done it all himself, which is pretty audacious and, you know, some would say hubristic thing to do or to claim.
Besides Jim, who else have you had the time and interest to investigate their lifestyle?
A lot of the people in my book, I've just read their theories and thought about their theories. And there's a few people who I've actually met and really tried to understand personally. One of them is a theorist called Michael Evans, who's lives here in Laguna Beach. He's not actually in the book. I encountered him after the book, but I looked into his life and his work quite a lot. One of the things that I find interesting about these people is that often they're incredibly bright, incredibly creative thinkers, but they've had little education.
They have nothing that they can use as a frame of reference.
That's right. So in a sense, they're beginning in a vacuum, and they've got all of these ideas about what makes sense, what should make sense. And so they start off on their own tangents, and then they get so into their own ideas, they can't actually hear any criticism based on, you know, experiments that have been done. So it's rather, at a certain point, the dialogue can't really go very far.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in Jim's case, he actually has read quite a lot of science.
Yeah.
So you can actually have really interesting conversations with Jim about mainstream physics, like why he thinks relativity is wrong or why he thinks quantum mechanics is wrong, because he's really read quite a lot. But at some point still you have this problem. What is the interface between what you're doing and the world that physicists actually find out through these deep and rich experiments?
Theoretical physics is totally different from the pragmatic physics.
That's a very good point. And that's really the stumbling block that ultimately comes about for many of these people, is they're doing theoretical physics. They're trying to found the foundations of reality. What's matter? What's space-time? How did the universe come into being? And they're not so interested in the application of it, like how do we make better microchips? Mm-hmm. How do we get rockets to fly to the moon?
Yeah.
And at some point, actually, theoretical physics, mainstream theoretical physics, produces theories that do actually help us to build better microchips.
Mm-hmm.
And that actually, I've come to realize, is the stumbling block with these people. They want the theory, but they don't want to have to prove it by producing better microchips.
Yeah.
And so there isn't this kind of continuum between theory and practice that is really the great achievement of contemporary mainstream physics.
When you went and spent time with Jim, he showed you what his machine that blows smoke rings.
Yes.
And then what is Circulot? I mean, there are some drawings here that have to do with nitrogen 13 and various things that have to do with, almost if you were seeing Einstein's EM3.
Yes. Well, the pictures that we're looking at here are Jim's models of what he thinks atoms are made of. Jim believes that all matter is made up of these little ring-shaped particles, rather like my bracelet here, and that they interlock together in these kind of like subatomic chain mail.
Mm-hmm.
And he'd like to do some experiments to test his ideas about these circlons, and one naturally occurring form of it is a smoke ring. So in his backyard at Inamclaw, he makes giant smoke rings, and bashes them together and sees how they behave, and it's amazing. When they actually bash together, they bounce off one another like billiard balls, which is really unexpected. They've got incredible integrity. They're really quite beautiful to watch.
And the Circulon?
Well, the Circulon is the name that Jim gives to these basically these ring-shaped particles, which he thinks is the fundamental structure of matter. He thinks that matter, all matter, is made up of these little ring-shaped particles, and that's the shape that he calls a Circulon.
What does he think of quarks?
In Jim's theory, quarks don't exist. There's no such thing as quarks.
Oh.
In his theory, there are electrons, protons, neutrons, and mesons. They're the four. They're four of the basic particles. And in Jim's theory, that's all there is. So all this other array of particles that physicists are finding now, like quarks and the Higgs boson that we've just discovered, in Jim's world, they're just fantasies.
Where does he go with all of these concepts from where he is now?
Well, he says that he's worked out the basic structure of physics. He's got a theory of nuclear physics. He's got a theory of, you know, the universe. Yeah. He's got a theory of gravity.
Fine. Who's going to take that up and use his theories?
Well, he would like to think that one day his theories will be taught in physics departments at Harvard and Princeton and Stanford. So he believes that a new generation of young physicists will finally realize that he is right.
Oh. That's how marvelous to have that sense of security of your own invention.
And that is a remarkable thing about Jim. He is so convinced that his theory is right that it doesn't matter to him almost if he's recognized in his own lifetime. Uh-huh. He'd like to be recognized while he's still alive. But if that doesn't happen, he's utterly sure that one day he will be.
He's very fortunate to have Linda as his wife.
Yes. Jim is a very wise man in a lot of ways, and he chose his wife extremely wisely. His wife, Linda, is a former social worker who worked in the King County social work system with disadvantaged and abused children. And she's the most level-headed, sane, and wonderful woman.
Uh-huh. And their children?
They have two grown sons now, both of whom have very successful careers. One's in a construction manager with a successful business building things like Starbucks, and the other one is a computer programmer. So they're both highly successful
young
men.
So the computer programmer, in a way, pursued his field.
Well, Jim has a great interest in all things technical. Mm-hmm. And so, for instance, he's used computer programs, software, to make his own animations of the creation of the universe. And his son, in that sense, has followed in Jim's footsteps.
Now, you were not the first science writer to receive everybody's thoughts. This man on this page, De Morgan, has been he was a collector of all of these ideas.
Yes. In the 19th century, there was a very famous mathematician, Augustus De Morgan, who's one of the great mathematicians of the 19th century, who spent 50 years collecting alternative theories of reality. Just after he died, a huge compendium of these theories was published. It was the whole book was called A Budget of Paradoxes, which is, I think, is a fabulous name.
Yeah.
And what I was interested in about this is that this phenomenon is not new. It's been going on for at least 150 years.
Somebody has to be at the other end of this writing that I am doing, and thank God for the post office.
Exactly. And one of the things I loved about De Morgan's book is that he's very